Joining me in our second segment to dissect another troubling week in national security is one of our regulars, Professor John Blaxland from the Australian National University. Well, John Blaxland, I think we both threw our hats in the air and gave three rousing cheers like a Queen's birthday parade when the announcement of greater collaboration with UK and US came through. Likewise, the decision to acquire nuclear-powered submarines, not nuclear-armed submarines. Greg Sheridan, though, put things in perspective in a pretty tough piece last week. I thought, if anything, Shero had probably gone a little bit too hard, but estimates this week, it's looking like another great acquisition story not in the Australian annals of 2040, Admiral Meade tells us.
Now, we've got a track record of making, making bespoke options for a country that just doesn't have the critical mass to sustain that.
Yep.
And we blow out prices, we blow out timeframes, we blow out the numbers too.
Yep.
It is a real tragedy, but it's one that we just can't afford to keep doing this.
Yep. You know,
because the stakes are getting higher, the consequences are getting more significant, and we just need to be much more level-headed and reasonable, and we really have to keep the politics out of this as best as we can.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things about defence policy over the years, by and large, has been pretty well bipartisan, and it's good to debate the issues, no question. It's important to debate them, but I'm concerned that we're playing a little bit of politics with this and trying to wedge people, and you know, and I think it's too important to be wedging over something so consequential.
Yeah.
And we need to be very, very clear-eyed, dry-eyed about what we're doing and how we're going to make this work with a US and or a UK combination. And it's going to be tricky however we want to cut it.
Agreed. And I think all of our audience would be sitting there tonight, and the polls have shown most people are now rather concerned about China, as they should be.
Mm.
2040 for the first delivery of submarine, when we're talking about, we have now said, precious little lead time. We can't afford to count on lead time, as we used to in the old days, on an evolving threat.
Yep.
What are the workarounds? Talk us through some of the things. Like, I know the P-8 can kill a submarine further from our shores. Walk through some of the options that can let our audience tonight feel a little more secure that these submarines are not leaving a massive hole in their littoral defences.
So, firstly, the Collins is world-class. The current submarine is about as good as you can get and have a diesel electric propulsion.
Gotcha.
So they are good. The life of a type extension will make them work for the next 15 or so years, hopefully 20. So that's good. But we don't have the option, it appears, to lease one, to borrow one from the Brits, the French, all the Americans, and no one else makes them in a way that is going to be compatible with us.
Yes.
So that really means that we're in a bit of a bind.
Yeah.
And we're probably going to have to get the Brits and or the Americans, probably both, to start rotating their nuclear propulsion submarines in and through Australian waters to generate the deterrent effect, effectively, which we're looking for. So AUKUS, you know, people have been saying, I had the conversation with one journalist recently, talk about the AUKUS pact. I'm thinking, hang on a minute, it's not an alliance.
It's not a pact,
It's a technical agreement on information sharing on IT about nuclear propulsion and about long-range missile and hypersonics and AI and related technologies.
Of course.
It's about us developing in Australia greater deterrence, so in a way that's complementary to what the United States is trying to do, and in a way that gives, I guess, the UK a bit of buy-in in Australia and in the Indo-Pacific in light of Brexit. So the combination of factors at play here, but the submarines options are few and far between on the table.
It's
and that does mean, I think, and Marcus Helly has made this point with, he's made the point that we're probably going to have to have a stopgap conventional submarine.
Yeah.
Because there's no nuclear propulsion options that we can fill. And really, I mean, we've got six Collins submarines. They're great. Mm. But, you know, back in 2009, we talked about having 12. Mm. We're 12 years later, we don't have them. If we go to the life of type extension, we're probably going to have three of them offline, if not four offline, so maybe only one or two viable, which really does mean we're going to be, you know, if what we're seeing is a more assertive China, a more difficult and dynamic security space in the Indo-Pacific, we're going to need more deterrence. Now, that can be fixed partly by greater long-range strike. So the weapon systems, the P-8 you mentioned are part of it, the greater capability for our joint strike fighters and the F-18s, the Super Hornets, but also on the ground forces and then the naval capabilities, greater long-range precision strike capabilities for our ships and the equipment for the ground-based air defence capability for the Army as well. I mean, let's not forget, people tend to think it's all going to be about subs, but what you need in a more uncertain environment is a suite of options.
Yeah.
Because if you structure your force just for one capability, and this is something that some of my peers and colleagues have argued about, you know, let's just have subs or let's just have subs and fighters.
The debate's gone down that burrow,
What you do then is you then actually situate the appreciation and you make a potential adversary structure their response to avoid your capabilities. So we do have a really difficult time ahead. We've got some hard choices to make. And I do think we are going to have to make some quickly about getting something from one of those partners out there in the short term. And, you know, the son of Collins, I mean, it's talked about, you know, the COCOMS-based design for the Collins is...
you could do it during the LOTE.
You'd think so.
Effectively develop son of Collins. Look, just another point in relation to that that was a positive development, that was the ASEAN dialogue that, despite some hesitations that were voiced by Indonesia and Malaysia about our decision about the submarine, that has now become a strategic partnership. Now, that's escaped a lot of attention. Walk through why that's important for Australia.
So ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, some people talk about it as a broken reed. Right, it's dysfunctional, it doesn't work very well. People are making the wrong kind of comparison. They compare it to the EU, the European Union. It doesn't have that kind of central governing body.
Yeah.
You don't elect a government of ASEAN like you do for EU. So we've got to recognise its limitations, but its benefits and its utility at the same time. Imagine the world without ASEAN. And the world without ASEAN 50 years ago was in a disease-infected, war-torn, poverty-stricken Southeast Asia where we went there to fight wars, not to go on tourism. Now, it's 50 years later. It's a transformed space, I would contend, in large part because of ASEAN. ASEAN matters to Australia. Security, stability is the ground bed upon which prosperity can prosper, right? So I think ASEAN really matters. That's why we've invested in this strategic partnership. Successive Australian governments have invested in the ASEAN relationship. So the ASEANis kind of look at us, they think sometimes we're a bit clodhopping and barely monolingual, as I like to say.
They know we're persistent.
But our heart's good. Our heart's in the right place. We're benign. We're not a threat to them. Even Indonesia, you know, the country we've been most concerned about in the past.
Of course.
Over East Timor and other things, their forces are postured facing northwards, they're not worried about us and they're not a threat to us either.
And I interpreted that coalescence as a very subtle sign that China is in fact unifying the region through its behaviour.
Interesting you say that, because what people are saying behind the scenes, and I was just involved in a conversation recently, a survey of pundits around Southeast Asia, and what they're prepared to say in public is quite different to what they say to us in private, you know, which is actually, by and large, we respect what you guys are doing in Australia. We don't want to be too overt in publicly acknowledging it, because then we're going to cop it from China. But actually, keep up the good work, Aussies.
And
you know, which is ironic because, you know, Australian diplomacy cops it on a number of fronts. And I was just in another conversation, Gareth Evans was making the point, a fair point, you know, Australian diplomacy has been shortchanged lately. It's smaller than it should be. I think our diplomatic presence should be bigger, more substantial. And yet we have top-notch diplomats. They really do a good job. We should be more supportive of them. And we should...
Good outcome on ASEAN, and we'll have to leave it there just as you're warming up. keeping people from the wicked. Always a pleasure, John Blaxland.